My name's Richard Small. I'm the resort director here at Auchrannie Resort on the Isle of Arran. I've worked for the company now for 27 years in total. I started here when I was 14 as a kitchen porter. I got a summer job just for part-time. And then from there, I then went to college to do chefing. From then, I gave up chefing because back in the day, it was like chefs were all crazy, not like they are nowadays. went back to hotel, to college to hotel management. So I started at James Watt College in Greenock. I then came across to Arran back at like the weekends to get a part-time job to help fund while I was at college. Then when I finished college, I started here full-time, and I've had various roles over the years. I started in reception, I then went in, I was in restaurants, sorry, then back to reception, and then I became one of the assistant restaurant managers. I then moved back into reception after that. I then left for about 2 to 3 years, went to Glasgow, worked for a company called Malmaison, and got quite a lot of experience when I was there. Then I came back to Auchrannie because I got offered the reception manager's job. I've then had various roles since then, including sales and marketing manager, which I started a open university degree on. Still never got it finished, been too busy. then got assistant manager roles, then became deputy manager, I then became ops manager, and through that career I've had a lot of development and investment within me from external resources as well as internal to grow me. Then I became general manager for about 7-8 years ago, and for the last year I've been the resort director.
So out of all those roles that you've had, what would you think, or what would you say was the most challenging out of those? You've come from, you know, shop floor level, if you like, to now being, you know, managing the whole resort, and obviously, you know, the resort itself's expanded hugely over time. What out of those roles would you say was the most challenging, and what one gave you the most sense of satisfaction?
I would say my role now is the most challenging because I'm responsible for everything.
Yeah, I think the fact that you have, you know, undertaken, you know, a lot of roles within Auchrannie and Malmaison, do you think that gives you an understanding and a real perspective of what the challenges that your staff are facing every day?
Massively, yeah.
Yeah. Huge. What I'm trying to say there is that, you know, did you always have ambition to progress in your career, or, you know, was that a case of kind of circumstance led you to that, or?
No, I've always known where I wanted to get to and how I wanted to get there.
And I suppose in terms of, you made reference there to, you know, learning from individuals within the organisation as well, did you consciously look at how they manage people and how they manage situations and pick up certain bits that they do?
Yep, because not everyone has been correct in what they're doing as far as I'm concerned, I've taken bits from lots of individuals over the years, whether it's been people in working environment or out of working environment. I've always looked at who's doing that the best way, or how could that be done better.
And criticism though, I mean, it's never easy for anyone to say, you know what, I don't think you're doing that particularly well. Or have you always been open to that?
Always been open to that. And if you ask the senior team at Auchrannie and even the general staff within the resort, as an organisation, we very much get feedback anonymously because people don't want to give it face to face, but we do it face to face. We encourage that. And over the years, I've gone from someone who's worked at 100 miles an hour, 90 to 100 hours a week, to somebody who is not slow paced but a lot slower and calmer than what I used to be. I know there's a lot of people, if you were to look at me and people say, oh my god, he's a total extrovert, he's full of confidence, he spin plays, he entertains, he's centre of attention, and he's big and booming out there amongst the staff. That face has actually been developed over the years because of the job role I do. If you were to ask me what am I out of work, I'm the exact opposite. I like being on my own or being in my own space. I don't like crowds, I don't like talking in front of people, I would avoid going to things.
That's funny,
to be on my own. and I don't have friends around the house because I can't bother, just want peace and quiet. I go out with my bike on my own, yeah. I walk the dog, yeah. So it's exact opposite.
Well, that surprises me because I only know you in a work, you know, a work environment, and you come across as very confident, very personable and comfortable being the centre of attention. So that kind of, you know, that does surprise me. That, so what are the biggest challenges to making that ambition a reality going forward?
Biggest challenges, staffing.
Yeah.
In terms of, and I know everybody in Ireland says this, housing.
Yeah.
So housing is our biggest challenge. I know we do go on about it an awful lot, but for example, we're just investing 1.5, 1.6 million pounds in building 3 new houses up the glen for our staff accommodation to build better quality housing. We, 6 years ago, we had, I think, 40 to 50 staff bedrooms. Mm-hmm. We, by the 1st of March next year, after the new build, we will have 101 bedrooms for staff to live in.
Yeah.
It's colossal, yeah. It's massive.
Yeah.
But that's us trying, we need to do that to run our, and to operate our business. However, people then don't stay long term because just having a bedroom in a staff accommodation, although it's all en suite, it's brand new and it's lovely, people want to settle down, but they then, good people that we have leave all the time because they've now got a partner, they've got married, they want to start a family, they can't afford a house in Ireland.
Mm-hmm. Brexit and the potential implications, you can walk around, you have traditionally had you know, a large number of staff from, you know, as well as Ireland, you obviously staff from all across the UK and from mainland Europe. How have you, as a business, tried to manage that to date? And what's your thinking moving forward? How do you maintain those staff levels?
So, as an organisation, we looked at just staffing in general, whether it's Brexit impact or whether it's a fact of the island location and the housing shortages on the island. We've implemented a number of factors, which has been real living wage. So the we pay the real living wage, we'll be paying more than all the other businesses, so hopefully we'll attract more local people. Also we offer the live-in positions as well at an affordable cost. So hopefully the people that haven't left because of Brexit that are still staying will come to us because we're paying more, we're offering the live-in accommodation. We do offer excellent training and development and career development, so we've focused very much, and we always have done, and it's not just because of the Brexit situation or the island situation, it's just we're very much focused in and our people.
So in terms of the impact today, you know, even though we've not progressed to a formal Brexit situation as of today, it might change tomorrow, have you noticed a change of difficulty in getting staff?
Massively.
Yeah, yeah.
This year has probably been our toughest year at recruiting.
Yeah.
We have, using agency staff for the first time ever in housekeeping, we have people, we're basically paying for people to travel from Glasgow, Central Belt, to come over here.
Personally, Richard, I think, you know, a lot of people will be aware of you through your role at Auchrannie. In terms of, you know, you made reference earlier on to, you know, time on your own, jumping on your bike and, you know, disappearing. In terms of relaxing away from here, it's, you know, is it music, is it film, what you know, what's your kind of downtime? What do you
holidays.
Holidays.
Try to have a holiday every 8 to 10 weeks. That's the key.
Yeah. Is that what keeps you sane?
Yes, it does.
Yeah.
So whether it's a city break or a week's holiday, every between 8 to 10 weeks, we try to go away for a long weekend or a holiday.
And is that extenuated, do you think, the fact that you're on an island? Or do you think that would be similar if you were working on the mainland, do you think?
It would be similar if it was on the mainland.
You touched on there the hospitality industry and making it a career, a sector of choice. I think it's fair to say that certain sectors of the tourism industry get a bad rep in terms of career development. So what would you say to someone who was considering a career in tourism and hospitality? What would your advice be to someone who's considering?
Well, if you were to think about it, people just think hospitality is just serving tables, washing dishes, cooking food, and making beds. Mm-hmm. That's not what hospitality is about. Mm-hmm. There are massive career opportunities in hospitality from if you think what industry employs the diversity of people. So we have engineers, mm-hmm. maintenance engineers,
yeah.
we have accountants,
yeah.
we have sales and marketing people, we have business development people,
yeah.
we have all different aspects of your mm-hmm. business within mm-hmm. here. It's not just about that. As a resort director, I cover all these aspects,
yeah.
but it's like there's huge career opportunities. Yeah. I got told in school I would become nothing. I hated school.
that was one of my further questions further down the line was, what advice would you give to your kind of 14-year-old self in terms of, you know, career choice and career progression? And I suppose you touched on it a bit there.
So basically, soak up as much information as possible.
Mm-hmm.
Listen. If you don't know, ask questions,
mm-hmm.
and don't let anyone ever tell you
mm-hmm.
that you're stupid or you'll never succeed at it.
Yeah.